listening to a Songwriter's Right Radio, only on LA Talk Radio.
Just love lyrics alive. It's a Songwriter's Right.
Absolutely, absolutely. What is going on, beautiful Hollywood? I'm your boy, Scotty Grand.
My name is Leo Moctezuma.
My name is Guy B.
And I'm Honey Baby.
And you're listening to A Songwriter's Right. Y'all, well, it's all about love, it's all about lyrics, and it's all about life, like we do every week that we hear y'all. What's going on, panel?
Yes.
Y'all looking good today. You got your colors, Tanisha. Got
yes,
your,
honey.
Got your whatever you call them. How y'all feeling today, y'all? It's just us today. So we're the guests, and today our subject is drive and determination, the real X factors of the real songwriting music industry. What y'all got to say about that? Let's just open this discussion up right now. And let's just say, by the way, we want all of you guys to call in because you guys are the guest, let's say, tonight. We want to hear your questions. We want to hear your thoughts. 818-570-5085. Oh, you better get it for me. Yes.
I got your back, son.
So you guys, drive and determination. When you guys hear that, and I know, Guy, you've been in this industry. Maybe I think you're the oldest on the panel tonight.
Ooh.
Oh, it's okay.
You better
revel.
I posted it.
You better revel. Okay. Does that mean for you, drive and determination? And why are those the real X factors when it comes to being successful?
Man, I think drive, determination coupled with passion, because it's the passion that you feel for what you're doing, or the happiness, or the, you know, just the fulfillment that you get from it. And I think that sometimes that is lacking. When you have drive and determination, you don't actually get fulfilled. So coupling those two is a challenge, and sometimes you feel like, you know, you have to make money, but then you can't make music, and then you make music, but you can't make. So the drive and determination really is to like marry all those things together. And I really found that for me, when I focus on what I'm most passionate about, when I focus on what I love.
Which was what?
Focus on it. I mean, first and foremost, it's voices, it's melody, it's lyrics, it's songs, it's emotion through voices and melodies and lyrics, and the greatest voices like Whitney Houston, or, you know, just the gift of that is astounding to me. And so, I focused on that, and I actually was an artist for a very long time, and focused on that, and song wrote and focused on that, but also found that I'm great at bringing people together, and that I'm great at facilitating projects, and that I'm great at executive producing, you know, complete projects and complete pictures and visions and things. And so you just have to take everything that you're really good at and use it and put it together in a way that works for both the money part and the music part.
Totally. 'Cause
it's not just doing music that will keep you in doing music. So,
but
you got to figure that out. You got to figure out
what was the roadblock that you had to overcome, or some of the roadblocks that you had to overcome with being determined to, like, even though you're going through this storm or this hardship right now, that you're going to be determined to get over it and continue to stay on the journey, you know?
Wow. I don't know if we have enough time for that, but what I will say,
just an hour.
It's different actually as an artist, and it's different as an entrepreneur, and it's different as, you know, just a person in general. I think in being an artist, you do have to take care of your business. You have to take care of your life. You have to take care of your art. And it's almost like those three things are separate. So there are different answers for each of those. But really the focus of doing for me as an artist, it was that I compared myself to the greats. So I would compare myself to Wanya Morris and Whitney Houston, and, you know, people who went to church and be like, God, didn't go to church, so I can't be that good. Even though when I'd open my mouth and I'd sing,
you
had a great voice and I sounded like it, you know. But so that was a lot of internal stuff. And then actually, now that I think about it, it attracted some of that from these great people that I met. So when my very first time that I ever went into a recording studio was I'm not gonna say the name, but it was with somebody who was very like, you know, important to me, and he was working with Babyface at the time, and he had put in a boy band together. This is before NSYNC and Backstreet Boys really actually even blew up. And mm-hmm. you know, he got us in there and he was like, sing this note. And I said, and it was the very first time I'd ever been in a recording studio. So I was very unfamiliar and almost uncomfortable, especially, you know. So he'd be like, sing this. And I sang it and sing that. And I sang it. And he's like, oh, this is a little sharp. This is a little flat. And I wasn't, you know, I was so uncomfortable. But long story short, he basically said, like, I left the session that day and the manager called me and said that he said you have a pitch problem and you're kicked out of the group. And I was like, what? 17.
So he was putting a group together. You were going to audition for it.
We had already put the group together.
Oh, wow. And he kicked you out because what?
Because of that one session, because whatever happened in there. Wow. Yes. And so from then on out, like, I had this real fear of a recording studio and of, like, when the red light came on, like, I could sing the part. I knew it. I was, you know, I had, you know. Then the red light would come on and I'd be like,
freeze. Like, I don't know what
I'd
to do.
Freeze. Wow. And so, you know, so it was a lot of determination to get through that fear because it meant so much to me that this person who was working with Babyface and Toni Braxton and everybody said this about me. So it took a lot of that. But when you keep going, and I got myself into boy bands, and then we did, like, and I really, you know, trained, and I really put myself in a position where I sang a cappella songs and rehearsed a cappella songs every single night.
You was like,
I'ma
stay
band.
On key. I'ma stay
yes,
on key.
Yes, yes.
You got another harmony.
I love that. Well, that's awesome. So you definitely know about having to be determined.
So you have, even through the fear and through, like, all the not worthy and not good enough. And I don't know that it ever goes away. Yeah. And right. I think that's just a songwriter's right or an artist's right to just keep
you said it.
Moving.
You said it. That's
moving,
a songwriter's
moving,
right,
moving.
Baby.
And then I won't even going, go into, you know, the challenge of an entrepreneur, because when you have a business and when you have a professional studio and when you have people that are really counting on you and people that are expecting things of you, money-wise and all that, that's another, you know, then there's accounting and then there's a team of people and then you got to be able to do that and be determined and have a drive to know how to manage and know.
I think is a huge part of you know, being a songwriter and not just being a songwriter, but being a business-minded songwriter. I'm just not writing songs, but I'm writing songs with this artist in mind and they're going to cut it on this date and we're going to get the advance and we're going to get the producer fee here and I'm going to get the split sheets done here and it's going to land on this and this person's getting this many points. You know, and having that business mind while you're songwriting, which is a whole different animal.
That's a whole
you know,
is.
That a lot of people aren't.
That's
really.
That's why we have management.
Okay. So T-Baby, you tell me what is drive and determination? Because I know you have come up against some crazy, just obstacles in life.
Man.
Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know if you know, I'm going to say it, Tanisha, because you know, you're so open with the world.
Yeah.
But you've lost a child.
Yeah.
You've lost a child. And I still see you when I'm so happy to call you my friend, because I love being friends with strong motherfucking people. You know, strong people who persevere through the toughest of times and come out even more beautiful than you thought they would ever come. You know, and so tell me how drive and determination plays in your whole
world. Oh, God.
World.
I mean, I think it's everything that you pretty much live off of. You know, I think people use the word, you know, faith a lot, you know, but. You know, sometimes faith without works is dead, you know, they kind of say. So drive and determination is what's going to get you to exactly where you're trying to go. Mm. Regardless of if you suck, regardless if you're amazing, you know, you get put in positions a lot of times in life where you just have no choice but to go. You know, and I always say it's go season. You know, it's ready. It's just time to go.
And you know, people say that a lot, but it comes the time when it's really just time to no bullshit. I'm just doing it.
You don't want to wake up, you know, and realize people have, you know, left. People have died. People have, you know, you parts of you have died. You know, your knees is bad and shit. You know, you got to get to the point where you come and you say, you know what, I'm going for it. And you take every single bit of learning experiences, every bit of tears that you've cried and, you know, the pain and all that shit. You take it, you go. And that's the drive and determination.
And, well, I'm really curious because you come from a family of successful songwriters, right?
Yeah.
And so what do you see or how do you see their determination and drive,
you know,
and how it played out?
Because
some major songwriters in the family, right?
If you guys don't know, Tanisha's brother wrote Fine China for Chris Brown.
Yeah.
I mean, Rockstar. He's amazing. Rockstar was going to have to come on the show. I shout out Rockstar with our brother. No, he's amazing.
And then
tell us about
that. My sister, you know, she's an amazing writer. She's phenomenal. She, like, if you, I mean, if you like Sharon. Adele, you're gonna like Sharon.
Yes.
Yeah. So, you know, it's the same type of thing. So,
you were able to witness their
I'm the oldest. So, you know, a lot of my spunk and attitude and drive and determination, you know, falls upon them, you know, because they think that's what they see.
That's why I'm
you
the
know?
Oldest.
Yes, I am. And so, you know, even us losing it, you know, me losing a child, and I say us because we're all family, but, you know, when you lose that, you know, people go to rock bottom, you know, just like an addict. You know, you get to that rock bottom, you can't believe you're there, and then somehow you have to come out of it and be, you know, happy and spunky and loving life and stuff. So we went through a lot of trauma as kids, you know, growing up, and that's a whole nother thing. So we have no choice sometimes. When you get to a place, you just have to go.
So what is your what are you driven to accomplish today?
Man.
These days, what are you determined to have under your belt?
I am determined to be one of the, you know, one of the most influential, I think, Black personalities, you know, besides like a Wendy Williams or something, but just more where, you know, I can motivate people as opposed to taking, you know, from their self-esteem. You know, there's a lot of like live musicians and stuff that I'm in depth with, you know. So I want to bring the music side to the, you know, radio personality.
I think you're well on your way, bro.
Yeah.
That's so funny. Can I just say, I need to give a crazy shout out to everybody who's been involved with this show, because we have hit 11,000 viewers. And we got to give it up. And I want to say that it's been really cool, because Tanisha, you coming on the show, everybody's been like, oh, you got to bring that girl Tanisha back on. She had me rolling laughing.
I love you.
She had me rolling laughing. I said, that's my best.
I said,
that's what we do. So thank
you
for that. And I love seeing your determination, because it inspires me to keep going
and
doing
what. Thank you, and vice versa.
Okay, hello. So what about you, Mr. Makatazuma?
Wow.
What's your drive in it? What is that? What do those two palabras mean to you? Oh, palabras.
Palabras, look. Lo que significa es.
Dígame en español, ¿no?
No, no, no. Wow, drive and determination is definitely what I've had to have. And for
and
those
still.
Of you who don't know, I am a singer-songwriter, but my professional career within the last 15, 17 years have been a professional dancer and choreographer. And as a dancer and choreographer, the struggle is real. First of all, I've been very blessed. I had a career that, I mean, I wouldn't change for anything. Mm. But, and I'm going to read a quote a little later, but it's just so interesting. Like, you could be at the top of your game, you know, 1 year, 1 month, and then be at the bottom.
Oh yes,
real quick.
You know,
quick.
With
and
no
also,
warning.
Yeah, you have to really, really, really believe in yourself, because, and let the ego and every as good as you are, you have to let that ego go. Because, like, for example, my first, you know, I've been on tour with like Ricky Martin and Britney Spears.
Wow.
And like, after touring with them, I'm still have to audition. Once I get off tour, I'm back at square one with every Tom, Dick, and Harry, all the other dancers.
Cattle
like
call.
It doesn't like your resume only takes you so far. You know what I'm saying? Like, I've even had to audition for Britney again.
Wow.
Yes. I had to do that with Jordan.
Yeah.
I was like, I'm fired. Okay. Guess I'm auditioning again to prove it that I shouldn't have been fired. I'm like, oh, let's do it.
No.
Yeah, that's the game.
That's the game.
It is the game. But it's like,
you're constantly
having to prove yourself. You get no's all the time. You get yeses. You get maybes. And if you don't have that drive, and you have to believe in yourself.
Yeah.
Believe in yourself and know how good you are. And know that if that one ain't for you, it's not supposed to be for you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But that's really difficult. It's really difficult for people to, you know, why really? What? That should have been mine. I did so good. Yeah. Today.
Child.
I went to an audition. I killed that shit.
Okay.
And they weren't looking for me. They were, you know what I'm saying?
They wasn't checking for you.
No, and it's okay.
That's
okay.
That's how it goes.
I got to keep it pressing. You know, that's why I got a radio show to host anyway.
Okay. That's all right. That's right.
drive and determination is definitely, as an artist, in any career, you have to like go for it if you want to make your dreams come true.
And what are you driven to today?
Well, right now, I mean, my focus is on my music career, you know, and I mean, I ain't getting any younger, but it don't matter. There are no rules. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, I love, this is my passion now. The same way I had passion for dance, I took that shit around the world 10 times. Mm-hmm. I had a passion for choreography. I choreographed for some big artists like Pink and Madonna. Like, and now that's what I want to do. I want to touch people with my music, with my story, and because I have shit to say. And if it just touches one person, I'm happy. That's my, you know, that's my goal, just to.
I love that. I think that's a good something to be driven to.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I'll say what drive is to me, drive and determination. It's like when you're driving into Vegas, if anybody's ever been to LA and you're driving into Vegas and you see all the damn billboards for every damn casino in the world, and it's all lined up, and you're driving on that long desert road and you see them all lined up. Life is kind of like that. It's like all these obstacles just waiting for you to get to them, And it's just like you got to be prepared to break through. You have to go with it knowing that there's 20 more coming. And you know that this one is, that one hurt, but you know, I'm going balls to the wall, literally. And I'm not going balls to the wall, balls through the wall.
Okay.
You know, like, I ain't going to have no more balls.
No.
Okay, you know what I'm saying? Balls gone. You know, because that's the time of the order of the day, which is why I kind of changed my name to Scotty Grand, because I had to start embodying, like, what do I want to be?
Yeah.
I'm Scotty Granger, but I really want to be larger than life. And I am larger than life. My voice is larger. My personality, my everything.
Your
so,
music.
You know, and so I changed to Scotty Grand. I say, be grand or be gone, because I really started to have to live by that myself, because I'm like, if you got something that the world needs to hear, be determined enough and believe in yourself that it will get as good as it should be.
Yes.
So that the world can hear it like they need to hear it.
How do you get on all those reality shows? Was that drive and determination?
You know what it is? That
real.
Was drive and determination.
Absolutely.
You
Talk
know
about
what it
that.
Was? I think
not easy.
I realized that I had a personality.
Okay.
You know, and that
you ain't got no personality.
Okay. I got none, girl.
So dull.
Just can't even stand him, whatever. But speaking of that, one moment that happened in my career where I had to really fight through, I was cast on a reality TV show, and it was actually with Cara DioGuardi, and she, before Platinum hit, the last TV show that I got off of, she was a judge on that too. But I was 18, and I was going to Berklee College of Music in Boston, and they had an audition for this singing show. And I was new, a kid from New Orleans, staying up there from Katrina. And I went up there and auditioned in my Starbucks clothes. I was working at Starbucks, and I got on the show, killed it. And they flew me out to L.A. Long story short, it was rivaling American Idol.
Wow.
American Idol kind of low-key blackballed us with American Idol. And we got canceled. And we went from having 12 contestants with each having their tour bus with their faces wrapped on each bus to us leaving LA with 3 months worth of clothes in our laps on a 12 passenger van with all 12 contestants crammed in there going to
Shut
LAX.
Up.
They were tearing down the set for America's
Shut
Next Top Model
up.
To come in because they needed the set. We were done. The set was done. We were signing autographs 1 week.
Wow.
And the next week, we were seriously being shipped back to wherever audition cities we had came from. And in that moment, I was like, oh my goodness. Like, it's done? Like, wait, what you mean? And I had to learn, like, yes, this business is very fickle. And it's not an overnight success, really, 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 for anybody. Even the ones that become overnight successes, they become overnight successes into hell because they weren't prepared, you know, either way. But that drive and determination made me pack. The part I left out is when they canceled the TV show, they gave each contestant $20,000.
Hey.
Okay. And I was like, oh, a bitch is rich. Okay, I'm going to go stay in the whitest of neighborhoods ever. And I did, and I was broke within 4 months and whatever. And I realized, but I drove from Boston. I left college because I was like, I have to be in LA. I have to go to where my craft is going to make me become great. And that was 10 years ago.
Wow.
And, you know, and now I've been here. And then since moving here, I've traveled all over the world. And I've gotten so much education that I wouldn't have even gotten had I stayed in Berklee.
Yeah.
You know, but that drive and determination really made me pack up my whole apartment in one night.
Mm.
And I had $18,000 in my account. And I'm like, I'm going to LA. I picked up my best friend, Michael Cole. And we just drove. You know,
that's
what that means for me. And I'm still on it, you know, because I'm not really where I want to be yet.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what it's about. Like you said, Leo, like it ain't about how old I am or how much I weigh or what's going on, my skin dropping or how whatever.
Yeah.
As long as I have this passion and this gift inside of me, y'all gonna hear from me.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yes. In fact, you can still snatch it at any moment.
Okay, we in Beverly Hills, baby. You can snatch anything that wants to be stolen.
I will be 25 again in a minute. Hold on.
Uno. Momento.
I love it. I love it. So, Guy, what are you determined right now? I didn't ask you that.
Oh, man. Honestly, all of the work that I've done for many years, I believe, is very, what's the word? Brewing. Like, I think it could all kind of come to fruition with the studio and with everything that's happening around it. So I'm very determined to make that happen in a way that, you know, still stays fulfilling and still stays with its core values and core principles that started it. Because what one of the reasons why the studio, I believe, is so successful is because I really intended and desired for whoever walks in there to feel comfortable,
like
to
home.
Feel supported.
It feels like home when you walk in there.
Like home. Yeah. Because of my experience in the studio, my very first experience in the studio, it was important for me to then provide a space where nobody ever had to feel that. You know what I mean?
And now you're expanding that dream.
That's dope. So now I'm expanding
that's
it.
Awesome.
And so and expanding the artist development and expanding the philanthropy part of it all, which goes back to mentoring and developing kids and really being a part of raising money for music education in schools that don't have music education. So mm-hmm. It's all coming. I'm super determined to make all that happen, and it's happening.
Yeah.
Love it. Well, we want to know what you guys are determined about. What are you guys driven to accomplish? Because, you know, I know there's some global changers out there who are watching, mm-hmm. listening. Yes. All 11,000 of y'all. Y'all call us 818-570-5085. And now it is time for...
And this is Talk About It with Leo Moctezuma.
Oh, hit him, Leo.
Yes, sir. So this is my little segment called Talk About It. And tonight, we're going to talk about the motherfucking AMAs.
Oh.
Yes, honey.
American Music Awards. I mean, there's a whole bunch of singer-songwriters on that show, I think.
Right? I think.
First of all, I have to give a shout out to the one and only Jennifer Lopez.
Oh, J-Lo.
I've been blessed to work with her, so and she's a fellow Puerto Rican, so I mean.
Claps.
Oh, do we need him? Do we need him, Jennifer Lopez.
Yeah. Jennifer Lopez. Jennifer Lopez was the host of the AMAs 2015 this year, and she killed it. She looked amazing in everything she wore, of course. I mean, she's a Puerto Rican goddess. She started with her acoustic version of Waiting for Tonight, and then she smashed a freaking full-out dance routine to a medley of all the singers, all the nominees' songs.
Is that what that was?
Yo,
I was so trying to figure it out.
I was like,
yeah.
J-Lo, I think those songs been already recorded, girl.
I said
that
a long time ago, babe.
No, it was basically...
Are you coming out with a mixtape?
No, it was basically a dance tribute to all the nominees, all the songs.
I can't lie, I was lost for about a minute and 34 seconds.
Wait, but she was singing Ed Sheeran and shit? I mean...
Well, no, but she wasn't singing, she was just dancing.
Oh, got it.
She sure was. You're right, you're right. Yeah, you're right. Which she did fabulously.
She did beautiful.
I thought she did try and sing a little bit, and it was a little lip sync.
A couple of lip syncs.
It was a little lip sync. It was
lip sync.
Lip sync. No, I mean, you know, I wasn't there, so I'm gonna let that go.
Okay.
But the funny thing is that when she danced to Nicki Minaj's
Anaconda,
she gave a face like. Nikki, get over yourself.
Oh, Nikki did?
Yeah, that's what people are talking about.
No, because that's a little way.
Talk about it.
Talk about it.
I don't get along with you, bitch. You need to get my shit. Because they did not get along.
They didn't?
Like,
Why not?
I thought they had a whole issue with the...
Of asses?
Or American Idol or something.
Oh, no,
like
that was Mariah Carey,
right? But yeah. I thought they had an issue too.
No, I don't think so. But
maybe they did.
I think the issue is that Nicki Minaj is just not a nice person. Okay.
She's not. I think what she
just did that so we could talk about it.
I think that's it. No, I think that's it. Seriously.
You think she's not?
Low key, I could just tell. You know, you could just tell when people. And I don't know you, Nicki, at all. But I could just tell when you give me. with everything, and you kind of give me that fake little, yeah, you it's catty. You that catty bitch. I get it.
Yeah, absolutely.
I get it. That's, come on. Why you diving out on Mariah Carey? That bitch can sing you under the ground.
And the fuck?
Okay, don't do that. You know what I'm saying?
I don't like, I'm not a Mariah Carey fan.
I am.
No.
I know gay boys are all going to send me emails, but listen, I'm not a Mariah Carey fan.
But even like 90s Mariah, you didn't care.
I mean, 90s Mariah, she's cute, you know, a hero, you know, but... Well, she got to the glitter shit, bitch. No.
Glitter, she did pop off in the brain a little bit.
That record was fantastic for the record.
That's cute.
But so
just,
go ahead.
Yeah, but just to talk about a little bit, well, coming from a dancer's and choreographer point of view for J-Lo's performance, the only thing actually I didn't really like, which was the costumes were, they were hot, but they were so camouflaged that a lot of the beautiful pictures that the choreographer created wasn't really seen.
I kind of lost J-Lo a lot. I was actually...
Everybody had the same thing on, which is cool, but honestly, it's been it was really one of the best AMAs that I've seen in a while. Another person that was awesome was Selena Gomez.
Oh, I think literally, I became a really big fan of her.
Yo, she's
when I watched her
into
performance.
Her skin. She killed it. She was gorgeous. She was classy.
The dancers. I was watching
everything
with
about
Tina.
That.
Tina
yeah.
Landon.
Yes.
And we were talking about the choreography was so clean and like
so
forward
clean.
Thinking, but still classic.
Yeah.
It was dope. She had the best performance out of all of them
You're
to
right.
me.
Yeah.
You're
because
right.
you know, she
you,
wasn't
you
like,
actually tweeted that or you Facebooked
that?
I
tweeted
what?
It. I was
and
like,
I thought
oh,
that.
By the way, Selena Gomez had the best performance.
And then I saw it and I was like, that was dope.
She actually
that
did.
That was amazing.
Yeah. And then aside from that, and the choreo was amazing. Oh, no, I mean, hands down, Selena freaking killed it for me. Demi Lovato, confident, maybe.
Thick.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
She's trying
honey.
To sell it.
Thick.
But I'm not
that
buying
fucking
it.
Way.
I love the new record, but that performance, I don't think
well,
came together
let me
her.
Talk. I don't know Demi Lovato at all, but let me just talk to you, baby. When you can really, really, really sing, sometimes you don't have
really,
to
really,
really, really sing.
Singing today.
You got to finesse it. You got to finesh that gift because... you know you
it's
it,
hard
that's
for people
all I'm
to
saying.
No, yeah, just I mean we're going you know? She just doesn't. She's not in the pocket. Like
yeah.
She's trying too hard, and I
and she's
to
trying to
her.
Be sex kitten, which I get, girl. They want you to sell some ass, but
it's just too cold.
And then they had the audacity to wait, Scotty. They had the
I can't breathe. I can't breathe.
They had the audacity to pair her up with my fucking. Alanis Morissette.
Alanis. And Alanis is walking around like she got a
she
bus
alive?
Ticket that's stolen.
Right.
Just like,
yeah, alive, baby.
That chemistry was nothing.
Killing it,
and
though.
And it made me dizzy. The performance made me dizzy.
Because the cameraman was like, Alanis, Demi,
where
ass.
You going? Where y'all going? Where are y'all going? Where y'all running to?
You
whatever.
Know what? Alanis, though, is still... Alanis been eating. I see. Alanis been is grown
she's,
woman now, honey.
Well, she's a grown
right.
woman.
I love it.
She's sitting in her skin. And last but not least, one of my favorite... another favorite performers, Ariana Grande. She's actually, like... No, not so much.
I can't. And I know I just can't. And I know some
I
people who are on
asleep.
Tour with the homie AJ and my boy Troy Loretta on piano. But I don't know. I don't know. I can't understand anything. I can't understand anything Ariana Grande says at all.
She's actually getting better. I actually even
is
noticed
she?
Well, that was Janet's thing too. It was already.
But I mean, Janet.
Don't
was,
you
I
dare
don't
compare.
I don't know.
No,
that shit.
I'm definitely not comparing.
I can't understand anything she says, and she's so beautiful to look at, but I feel like she's
so
12.
Beautiful.
And I
she
feel like
looks
she's a porn.
And
12 beautiful.
Girl, and I'm like, I'm and lost, and I don't understand what she's telling me, but she sounds good. She looks good, but I'm lost. I don't know if I should be turned on or like, I'm lost. And but the heels were like the size of this computer screen. I'm
it
like,
was
whoa.
So stupid. You know what? I think.
But she's beautiful.
No,
let's
she's
just
beautiful.
Stop there.
She's. I think she's sitting in her skin more. She must be having sex. She must be getting fucked. Because that's definitely. Oh. Well, that's what I thought. That, she,
that is right. a vocalist pop star's right.
I mean,
ain't
that that's
wrong
what,
with
I think
it.
I thought that's what was missing. I think once she starts having a little bit more, you know, life.
Absolutely.
Lessons then. But that's what it is. That was
yes.
talk about it. And that's what I'm
going to
talk
what did you think about Justin?
Oh,
Justin Bieber.
I enjoyed it. I hated what he was wearing.
I think
his
I've been
stylist
hating.
Should be fired.
I've been hating every performance, what he's wearing. What
yeah,
he's wearing.
I don't understand.
The songs, though, make up for it all for me, though.
No,
I think the record. No, the
he
record
needs
is,
to not perform. He just
I
needs
agree.
To let the record do it.
Because that music is too good for him to be going out, what do you mean? I'm like, what do you mean? Do you want to do a pirouette or do you want to do a backflip?
He just wants to go fuck somebody.
No, but he's actually, those songs are actually out of here.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
You know.
They're amazing. Maybe. I think they're trying to dress him not to look like a lesbian, and it's not working.
You're just cute, Jay. You're just good, cute, Justin.
But
just,
I love the album, and I love... Oh, my God. Really quick. Shout out to my good friend, Jose Omar. He filmed and edited all the new videos for Justin Bieber.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, and he actually... my friend Jose did my You and Me video.
Oh, sick.
So I'm shout out to, I'm so proud of him.
All the dancer videos.
Yeah, basically his whole album. They made Justin Bieber produce dance videos for every song. And one of my good friends, he's also a dancer. He filmed and edited all of that.
I actually have to shout out one of my girls too. She's in Joe Jonas's band, Jinju.
Jinju
presented at the AMAs. Yes. Jinju, we are so proud of you, girl. You better do it all the way from Korea.
But you know what? She's just done everything.
No, she's done everything. But now she's doing it, and she's being a star.
Yeah.
You know, like she should be.
And all the black men that want you, girl. Okay. Just keep going.
So we're going to take a little break, y'all. This is the Songwriters by Radio. We're going to be right back.
Yeah.
Just love, lyrics, and life. It's the Songwriters Right.
Your boy Scott E. Grant, and I'm letting y'all know right now that I just put new music out today. Go to scottygrand.com. That's scottygrand.com, and go get You Got Me. Y'all leave comments. Let me know what y'all think. How you feeling it? If you not feeling it, which I doubt that you won't. But anyway, if you are, let a brother know. Go get it.
Just love, lyrics, and life. It's the Songwriters Right.
Yes, 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 it is, y'all. What's going on, family? How y'all feeling in the studio?
So good.
Good. You're looking good today, Tanisha.
Thank you,
you been
baby.
Putting some on your skin, girl?
No. It's dry.
Oh, you looking good. You looking good.
You've been like obsessed with the gym, though, right?
I've been working out every day.
You're looking like it. Yeah. I love it. You know what I've been obsessed with, and we're gonna get to that a little bit later.
Yeah.
But you guys, we got new music to premiere. This is the very first of Songwriters Right premiere, you guys. And if you guys don't know, A Songwriter's Right is actually the title of my album series. I'm putting out a series of albums, and I put out the first installment this July 19th, and the second is coming out in February on Valentine's Day. And this is a single, a song that is so dear to my heart. This whole thing kind of came about when I found out that I had fallen in love.
Yes.
You found out?
I found out because my heart told me. You know, I cared about...
You found love in a hopeless place.
Actually, I found love in a very hopeless. I mean, hopeful. Hopeful place. You know, I thought this was everything. You know, I changed my everything. I wasn't being a slut no more. I wasn't. I was on tour staying in my hotel room. Holiday? Let's just say that. What? Okay. On tour staying in the hotel room because I had to Skype. Okay. But anyway, so this project kind of came about because I got my heart broken after I fell in love. And I wrote all of these songs as a songwriter. And I decided to put them out on a series of albums called The Songwriter's Right. And the first series was first part is called The Love Is. And the second part is called Hate Will. And this is the first single off of it. And it's called You Got Me. Ladies and gentlemen, this song has already went platinum over in Europe. And this is the first time America is hearing it. This is my new single, which you can go get right now on www.scottygrand.com. This is You Got Me. Gentlemen, that is You Got Me for the very first time in America, the first single off the second installment of A Songwriter's Right. Go get that right now on scottygrand.com.
Yes. Talk about it. That was amazing, bro.
Yes. You guys, CeeLo wanted to cut that. Hmm. Am I crazy for not letting him?
No.
Yeah.
A little bit.
Yeah.
You know, but that's what we call our motherfucking songwriters, right? I wrote it and I'm singing it, okay?
You know? I know everybody's like trying to get all the songs they hear you. They're like, I want this artist to cut it. I want that artist, including myself.
And I'm like, I want this artist to cut it, you know?
How is that being songwriters and you wanting your song that you wrote and like, say Rihanna's like, you know,
that's the epitome of a songwriter's right. You having that right to say no. And some people call it dumb. Exactly. You know, some people call it dumb, you know. But you know what?
I don't know like how you guys deal with that, cuz that to me just would be traumatizing. Like shit, you release it, you'd be like, so 16 copies. And somebody else released it because it sold 16
million. 16 million, exactly. That's right. So true. But that's the part of it that, okay, you know, why you do this music thing. Are you determined to be famous and have everybody singing the lyrics to your song? Or you are determined to be happy? And that comes from you just doing music, okay, whether Rihanna cuts your song or you cut it. Mm. Some people, that determination is that you're determined to get to different destinations.
What about people that are amazing songwriters and not so great artists, but they want to be an artist very, very, very bad? There's a conflict. And so then you have your friends that's just like, well, you should really write. That's a really good thing. You know, that's an amazing thing.
But usually those songwriters have released projects that just don't do much, you know? And I think that's.
But that's why they shouldn't release it. They should just give it away.
But you know what? Honestly, I think I can call myself a singer, and my projects aren't selling like crazy. But I'm not doing it for that. I'm doing it so that I can get this out of my soul.
Okay.
I can get this out of my veins. Man. I can get this out of my essence, and for people to hear my story, whether they want to, you know, give me money for it or not. And I think, especially coming from New Orleans, well, I see people wake up with they tambourines and they trumpets and horns, and they going down the street with no teeth, and they playing their song to their 60.
That's right.
And that's where I come from, you know. And
that's amazing.
But this guy who's calling in right now, let's just talk to this guy right now. What's going on, Mr. Skyler?
Hey, what up? What are you doing?
What's going on, man? This guy is actually the producer of You Got Me.
Oh, wow! Good job.
Amazing song,
thank you very much.
So
did you guys already play it?
We did, man. We just played it. And you're in Minnesota right now for Thanksgiving, right?
I am in Minnesota, yes, sir.
I love it, man. So, man, finally we got this song out, Skyler.
Oh, my God. How long have we been waiting for this?
I think
how long have I been waiting for this?
I think like a good 3 years.
Damn.
Yes.
Oh, baby.
But you know that's all a part of, yes, for Garbage Can in the background. I love it.
So did he write, Skyler? You wrote the song, or did you produce the song? Like how would the collaboration work?
We both. I'd say the whole song was 50-50. Okay. I co-wrote and co-produced, and Scotty did the same. Scotty co-wrote, co-produced. A lot of the track itself is Scotty's voice.
Really.
Really?
Oh yeah! If you listen back to it, it's mostly like pads and stuff.
Dope.
We were going both he and I were going through some crazy stuff with our
significance
companions of that time, and we both came to the studio kind of heartbroken, and we just went for it. And that record is just amazing. That record's.
What have you worked on before, Skyler?
What's
up? What have you worked on before? Before, like anything we could go look at, or?
Oh yeah. Since then I've done a lot of stuff. Right now there's a record out by Jesse and Sky called You Got Me.
I'm about to say, this got my same title.
Sky, yeah. That I co-produced with the Insomniacs.
Oh, okay, that's dope.
I'm yours. There is tons and tons of stuff out in Japan and Korea and all over there. There's
love it.
I'm on slide deck here lately.
Well, how can we get a hold of you? What do you have, any social media pages? Some, you know.
I mean, the best thing right now, I'm starting a music project called Gorilla. So that's going to be, I'm going to start putting stuff up on that. If people want to start Googling Gorilla.
Say it again for
I'm
us.
I'm going to be putting out.
Yeah, put your sandwich down, baby, and come talk to me, honey.
He's like, so I got this podcast. Thank you.
Trying to make me hungry.
We all hungry over here. We can't eat till after show. He over here chomping on an apple.
Child, you make me hungry.
So say what you were saying.
You guys can't hear me or what?
No, we can hear the food in your mouth, baby. we can hear all that shit. It's clear as hell. Put that down and tell me how to get a hold of you. Instagram, Twitter, bitch. Ciao.
Oh, my bad. Okay. Yeah, go on Instagram would probably be the best. Skylar Moans, SKYLARMONES.
Boom. Boom. Skylar, you are hilarious. Yo, when you get back from Minnesota, we got to work and make You Got Me number two.
Of course. Done. Of course.
Done. And get that mix to me, motherfucker.
It's the songwriter's right.
Okay. It's the songwriter's right. You're damn right. Thanks for doing this rec with me, brother. And I'm so honored to have your work on my project. And I'm just a fan of what you do. And I'm happy we were able to do this together, my man.
Of course, man. Anytime, brother.
All right, Scotty.
You know, for everyone listening, Scotty is truly something else. Talented,
yes.
Person-wise, just everything. He is a genuine person, and he truly is a very talented person. Like, one of the things with You Got Me was we did not do that for Scotty's project. We did that for placement. But every time we tried to have someone play it, every time we had tried to have someone sing it, no one could ever sing it.
Right.
And it's incredible. Scotty's range on that record sells the record itself, and just no one could really cut it.
That's so a songwriter's right, baby. Here,
but there was a lot of big artists that cut that record.
That's beautiful.
And it just never made it on the record.
Even females, huh? Able to pull females it off. Couldn't even cut it.
You know, so.
Yeah.
I love it. Well, thank you so much for that, Skylar. I really appreciate that, man. Hopefully we make some good money with this one, yeah?
Oh, hell yeah.
For sure. No. All right, brother. Thanks for rocking with us, brother.
And just so you guys know, you can tweet us live. So you love cutting people up on that phone. Yeah,
guillotine.
Bye, Felicia. You can tweet us at ASWRLA. We're tweeting live right now. And we'll talk back to you. So
Boom. And now I know what time it is. Yeah. Now I'm time for ourselves. We only got a few minutes, so we're gonna go quick. Okay. We gonna go quick. Who gonna start? Go.
Okay, I'm obsessed with working out, you know?
Love
I've been
it.
working out my asshole. Doing my
Kegels,
gag reflexes. No,
I love that. So, what exercise have you been doing?
No, I've been really working on my squats, getting my little cardio in. It's just because my flapping foe, my stomach. I gotta.
I love it.
Holy shit!
You about to drown in your titties, man.
Drown in your titties.
So I would say that's you are obsessed. Guy, what are you obsessed with this
man,
week?
Man, I gotta be on this week. I'm actually obsessed with my family. Actually,
aww.
that's the truth. I'm obsessed with my mother and father, who actually live in Israel, and I speak to them on FaceTime. Abba and Ima, and I'm just like, they're just so amazing. Like,
yeah,
they're
are.
So incredible.
You come from good stock,
and they're just, have you talked to your brother? Have you talked to your sister? What's going on?
Yeah.
And I just noticed that. I'm like, that, you know, just having that I'm that kind of family. I'm mm-hmm. obsessed with.
Obsessed. Yes. Obsessed. Love it. What are you obsessed with, Leo?
I'm obsessed with two things, and I'll say them really fast. First, my Biggie Smalls.
Yes,
we love it. I'm obsessed with that.
I didn't even see that.
That's cute.
His face was real close. I didn't even see
that's a little fat boy.
I actually got this shirt in New York at Jeans Bar, and their Instagram is @jeansbar_. And they had the flyers on Dykeman in Washington Heights, in the Heights. And they're dope. But the second thing I'm obsessed with recently, and it's kind of I'm obsessed with just choosing happy.
Okay.
Oh, I like that.
Because times are rough right now. Like, you know, we keep it real. Like it's the holiday
people
seasons. It's
dying
been. I can only speak for me, but I know that just in the industry right now, it's really slow, and it's an easy time to get depressed.
Yeah.
I have friends who are like, I'm sad. I'm sad.
No, like everybody is sad, and I'm just like, and I'm just proud of myself specifically because I just choose happy. I wake up and I'm like, shit ain't right now, but I know it's gonna change. And you just gotta once again believe in yourself and believe that's what's gonna happen.
Yeah.
And just choose happy and know that, you know, God or your higher power and yourself is gonna make it right.
You know what I'm saying? I literally just choose eggnog.
Chow and a whiskey.
And that's driving determination.
That is driving determination.
It's all that, you know.
Totally. No, that's
what are
so
you
true.
Obsessed with?
I am actually obsessed with makeup.
Yes, I just came from Sephora.
As you
honey.
Can see, this face is big. Seriously, I go and see movies by myself a lot because I'm such a personality that I'd be wanting to shut up for whole days by myself. So I went to the Grove to go see some random movie that I hated. Shouldn't have paid $14.54. But there was a Mac store next door, and I went there, and I let the dude do my face for free because I love to do it, but he just sit and brush my face for free. And I was like, I don't know if I like it. Then I opened my eyes, and I was like, I love it. Yeah. And I was like, I'm switching. What's the number? 405 liquid. Give it to me.
I want NC 42.
And I would say that I was obsessed. Yes. I love that. I love that segment, y'all. I know. So let's keep this going.
Wow, what it is, y'all. Y'all already know what time it is. It's time for those Songsmith tips.
Oh, it's time for those Songsmith tips, baby.
Give it, and maestro.
You guys, I want to talk today to you guys about how to collaborate, how not to stop the flow.
Yeah.
Like when you're in a room with somebody, whether it's a big name or a small name, that person's ideas, that person's vantage point, that person's visions, that person's lyrics, that person's melodies is all valid. It's all part of the process of you two in that room because one mind, or two minds rather, is better than one.
Yeah.
Sometimes, you know, I think as a new writer, what I had to learn when I went into other sessions as a strong-willed person, and I know a lot of creative people are very strong-willed.
Yeah.
I had to go in and sometimes take an L for a line that I thought may have been better, or a melody that I thought may have been better, but for the sake of the session to continue to have a good vibe, and for the sake of the song, not my ego, I just shut up and I let it go. Yeah. And then when it came time for revision time, maybe 2 weeks later, I said my point again. And then they saw that maybe my point may have been better or not. But I still got to do it in a respectful way and keep my relationship and still keep that collaborator happy. You know what I'm saying?
And by the way, you are a great collaborator. Not only we've collaborated on many, many songs, but just anytime I put you in a room with somebody, I just know you're able to not only allow their genius to come through, but also facilitate it in a way that it's always totally comes out amazing. Seamless. And that's
what it's about. It's not about you. You know, when it's like, I know a lot of writers who go into the room and they're top writers, but when they're in there, they're all being assholes for the sake of the song, not the sake of their ego, not the sake of their Grammy.
Yeah, it's so true. It's such a difference between the ego of what you want to come through, or whether it's about what's best for the song.
Yeah, I was watching T-Pain do an interview, and he was saying the hardest or the worst writing session that he had was with Diddy, because he didn't let, you know, T-Pain do what he does. It was just like, oh, I don't like this. I want this. I want to go over here. And it was very controlling. So it was like, why am I here?
Like, why don't you just write the song?
Yeah, well, you should have wrote the song. you know, but that's funny, because collaborating is a big part, I think, of songwriting.
Totally.
From what I'm seeing.
Totally. I mean,
and music, because if you write and you play and you sing and you, it's like, yes, you could be like a very talented, but there's always a dimension missing, because it really is a marriage.
Totally. Yeah, it's timing. Timing is important. I mean, in any collaboration.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's a time and place to say what you need to say. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
But like you said, if the flow is going, you know, keep it cute and keep put it on
cute,
mute.
Keep it going. Yeah, you know, so that's it. So you guys, this was cute. This was nice tonight. This was good.
This
so
fun.
We done.
For sure.
Leo, why don't you tell them what we got for next?
Next week, I'm really excited. I'm thankful that we just have talented fucking friends.
Yeah.
But next week, our featured guest is former Pussycat doll, Miss Jessica Suda.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to be talking about her amazing solo career, like that she's been doing things. She's just released a new project, so we'll be playing some new music and talking to her. She'll be sitting right here.
Yeah.
And then also our new is a really, really good friend of mine. Her name is Davi Lorenzo.
Davi.
And,
I like that name.
Before next week, you can check out, we did a duet, a cover of Pink and Dallas Green's You and Me, and we did a music video to it as well. We'll play that next week, and we'll hear what she's going through and what her new music is.
So we hear every week. Actually, you guys, we only have two more episodes before the winter break, and we'll be back in February
for our second season.
A second season, baby. So you've been listening to A Songwriter's Right. Check y'all later.
Just love, lyrics, and life. It's A Songwriter's Right.